Hello everyone. Today, let's see the supporting structures in maxillary arch. In my last video, we went through the limiting structures. Let me take a moment to recapitulate the same for the sake of continuity. So, here we have the passive labial freedom, this portion marked in blue. These two are the buccal freedoms with active muscle attachments. The orbicularis oris pulls it forwards. The buccinator, which is situated behind, pulls it backwards. And levator anguli oris is going to pull it upwards. Between the two frenums, we have the labial sulcus, this blue line here, and the buccal sulcus between the buccal frenum and the hamular notch. Hamular notch is a small depression seen between the maxillary tuberosity, this bony prominence here called the maxillary tuberosity, and the pterygoid hamulus. This portion marked in green is the posteropalatal seal area, a cupid's bow shaped, which aids in retention of the denture and provides posterior seal. It has an anterior vibrating line and a posterior vibrating line. These marked in yellow are the fovea palatinae, which are ductal openings, so the palatal mucus glands. Fine. I recommend that you go through my videos in serial order so that you have a better understanding. Okay. So last class we saw the limiting structures, that is the structures which come at the periphery of the denture, that is the boundaries of your denture. Today let's see the supporting structures, that is your denture is going to, it's seated here. So let's see the structures here that is going to support the denture. Okay, see, when your denture is in the patient's mouth and when the patient bites and is in occlusion, during mastication, there are certain forces acting on the denture bearing area, right? Of the upper maxillary denture bearing area and of the lower denture bearing area. During mastication, deglutition, all those functions, certain forces are going to act on the denture bearing area. So those areas which are capable of withstanding these forces are called the supporting structures or the stress bearing areas. So far clear? Now, among the stress bearing areas, certain areas are capable of giving more support than the others. So those areas come under the category primary stress bearing areas, and those which can provide support only to a lesser extent are called this secondary stress bearing areas. Now let's see them in detail. So coming to the primary stress bearing area, the most important one, the first one, that is the posterior lateral portion of the heart palate. Here it's not marked, let me mark it for you. So the region which comes posteriorly and lateral to the midline, this portion is called the posterior lateral portion of the heart palate, and this is our primary stress bearing area. Clear? Posterolateral portion of the heart palate. Now why this is a primary stress bearing area is because, see, this area lies perpendicular to the direction of occlusal forces. See, when your denture is here like this, right, it's seated, and your occlusal forces are going to act straight like this, right, on your teeth. So this area is flat, and the trabecular pattern of the bone here lies perpendicular to the direction of occlusal forces. So it is best suited to withstand forces when it's situated so. Also, the mucosa overlying this area is keratinized, and the underlying submucosa is firmly attached to underlying bone. Clear? So all these features makes this area least prone to resorption. Okay, so these are the contributing factors which enables this area to be the primary supporting structure or the primary stress bearing area in the maxillary arch. I hope it's clear. Now let's proceed to the secondary stress bearing areas. The secondary stress bearing areas are 1. The rugae area, the maxillary tuberosity, and slopes of residual ridge. Okay, so can you see these folds of tissue here, connective tissue folds in the anterior portion of the heart palate? See, I said this whole red portion is a heart palate. In the anteriorly, we have these folds of mucous connective tissue called the rugae. Now this rugae area, this whole anterior 1/3 of the heart palate, becomes the secondary stress bearing area. That is, it's not capable of giving as much support as this area, but it's a secondary stress bearing area. Again, the reason, sir, the epithelium is keratinized, the underlying mucosa is firmly attached to underlying bone, and also this rugae area is situated at an angle, can you see, at an inclined angle. So what happens is, when the denture is in position, this inclined angle, this rugae area, prevents the forward movement of the danger. See, if the danger is pushed in this direction, this is prevented by this Ruge area. So all these make the Ruge area the secondary stress bearing area. Coming to the next one, the maxillary tuberosity. Maxillary tuberosity, I've told you before, it's a bony, bulbous bony prominence at the distal end of the alveolar ridge. This portion marked in yellow is the alveolar ridge, and we have the maxillary tuberosity at the distal end. Again, this is a secondary stress bearing area. Okay, this prevents, is capable of withstanding the vertical, the horizontal and torquing forces, and also it is least prone to resorption. So all these makes the maxillary tuberosity a secondary stress bearing area. Coming to the last one, the slopes of residual ridge. Actually, I found in some textbooks, they have mentioned the crest of ridge as a secondary stress bearing area, this yellow portion as the secondary stress bearing area. Well, I sort of disagree on it. See, the residual ridge means, see, can you see this portion? Residual ridge is the portion of the bone and the mucosa remaining after the removal of the teeth. Okay, so the patient first had teeth here. So once the teeth are removed, the portion of the bone which remains is called the residual alveolar ridge. Now this residual alveolar ridge continuously undergoes resorption, that is the height. This is the height of the residual ridge and this is the width. The height and width of the residual ridge continuously decreases as the patient ages. It's a continuous process throughout life. Okay. So that is what is called residual ridge resorption, RRR, residual ridge resorption. Now I feel this crest of the ridge is most prone to residual ridge resorption, especially in a patient whose teeth are extracted recently, who has undergone extractions recently. What happens is this crest of the ridge remains very bony and spiny. The extraction sockets are just in the process of getting remodeled. So I don't feel that you should consider this as a secondary stress bearing area. But the slopes of the residual ridge, this portion marked in white, the slopes, okay, the sides of the residual ridge, of course, they are capable of giving good support. Okay, so the sides, that is the slopes of the, it has two slopes, right, on either side. So the slopes of residual ridge can be considered as a secondary stress bearing area. And of course, the crest of the ridge can be considered a secondary stress bearing area only if the patient has been without teeth for a very long time. So what happens is this crest of the ridge undergoes bone remodeling and it becomes smooth and well-rounded. If it's smooth and well-rounded, okay, this area, if it's smooth and well-rounded, of course it can provide some support and it can be counted as a secondary stress bearing area. But as far as possible, I feel whenever the patient comes with newly extracted teeth, or hardly 3 months or 4 months have gone by without teeth, this ridge cannot give any support. Okay, so we have the slopes of residual ridge as the last secondary stress bearing area. So I guess with that we can wind up today's class. We saw the supporting structures in maxillary arch under two categories, the best support being provided by the primary stress bearing area, that is the posterolateral aspect of hard palate, and the secondary stress bearing areas are the Ruge area, the maxillary tuberosity and slopes of residual alveolar ridge. All these structures are capable of providing support because of some of the common features present in them, that is the epithelium is masticated, the mucosa is masticated mucosa having keratinized epithelium, the submucosa is firm, resilient and it is firmly attached to underlying bone, and the trabecular pattern in the bone is perpendicular to the direction of occlusal forces. So that's it. Next I'll be back with the relief areas in maxillary arch. Until then, take care.